Still has so many friends. Thank you. Who gives this woman to be married to this man?
Her mother died.
You can be seated. We're going to have a special time of prayer and blessing from the parents right now. So that we just ask you in this time, as you're in your seat, that you would take a moment to pray for this couple as they begin their marriage today.
Thank you. morning if you wake up and the sun does not appear, I will be here. If in the dark we lose sight of love, hold my hand and have no fear, 'cause I will be here. I will be here when you feel like being quiet, when you need to speak your mind. I will listen, and I will be here when the laughter turns to crying, through the winning, losing, and trying, we'll be together, 'cause I will be here. Tomorrow morning if you wake up and the future is unclear, I will be here. As sure as seasons are made for change, our lifetimes are made for years. So I will be here. I will be here, and you can cry on my shoulder when the mirror tells us we're older. I will hold you, and I will be here to watch you grow in beauty and tell you all the things you are to me. I will be here. I will be true to the promise I have made to you and to the one who gave you to me. I will be just as sure as seasons are made for change, our lifetimes are made for years. So I will be here, we'll be together,
We are gathered today in the presence of Almighty God and these witnesses to join Christian Patrick Poteet and Lydia Nicole Hewlin in the bonds of marriage. While this is a solemn day that marks the beginning of a holy and lifelong covenant relationship between this couple, it is also a celebration of love. Today we celebrate the love of a husband. We celebrate that a few minutes ago on the floor, Christian was in his father's home, under his father's authority, but as he walked up on this stage today, some things changed. And we praise the Lord for the big changes that are taking place today. We celebrate the love of a husband as the love of a biblical husband is a giving love. It's a love that sacrifices everything for his wife. Paul told the church at Ephesus, "Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it." God calls for a biblical husband to be giving of himself, sacrificial completely of himself for his wife. The love of a husband that we celebrate today, of a biblical husband, provides tender care for his wife. Paul went on to say, "So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. For no man yet hated his own flesh, but nourisheth and cherisheth it, even as the Lord the church." Up till now, when Christian was hungry, he ate. When he was cold, he put on a coat. And it's this type of idea that is behind these words, nourish and cherish, that you, out of the love of Christ, are to meet the needs of your wife. To fulfill the instruction that Peter gave in 1 Peter 3:7, to dwell with your wife according to knowledge. And Christian, I've already seen you begin to grow in a deeper knowledge and understanding of Lydia. I had a man tell me once when I was preaching about husband and wife relationships, and Laura and I hadn't been married that long, I was preaching about dwelling with your wives according to knowledge. And the older man came up laughing at me after church. He said, "That was so dumb. You will never be able to do that. I've never understood my wife, and I never will." And he walked out of the church. And I said, "Well, God has something to it. There's some level of understanding we have to have, or he wouldn't have written it there." And I've already seen you growing in your understanding of, why does she think this way? Why did she say that? And why does she do this? Or how does she process? I'm seeing you ask questions. I'm seeing you pay attention to what she says and look beyond just what she says to what she means. And I'm so grateful to see your example, even when before you were married, beginning to do that. I challenge you to continue doing that, and you will be able to, through the power of Christ, meet her needs physically, emotionally, and be the spiritual head of your home. So the love of a biblical husband is giving. It provides tender care, but it is also gentle and forgiving. In Colossians 3:19, we read, "Husbands, love your wives and be not bitter against them." It is your responsibility to make a choice, even on the hard days, even on the difficult days when it's been rough at work. And as a police officer, you will have plenty of difficult days at work. But to come home and recognize that you need the Holy Spirit's power to love Lydia, to be completely giving of yourself, to stay completely 100% committed to her, and in the difficult days, choose gentleness and choose forgiveness. Today we celebrate the love of a wife. The first statement is very obvious that I'm going to make here. The love of a wife is an emotional love. It's a love that we get to experience and we feel, and it gives us butterflies and makes us giddy, as all of Lydia's family and friends have witnessed in recent months. But it develops into a physical love, a physical relationship, and we're getting to behold part of that today as they held hands for the first time on the floor there a few moments ago, and as we will witness their first kiss today. And these firsts of physical affection, Lydia and Christian have chosen themselves out of the admonition of 1 Corinthians chapter 7, that it's good for a man not to touch a woman, therefore let every man have his own wife. And so they made the decision in their relationship to guard one another and protect one another, and one way to do that was to have a no-touch relationship until today. Some people are afraid there will be no electricity between the couple if that happens. And as the giggles of her sister identify, that has not been a problem. But we're grateful today to see the testimony that they have been and the encouragement that they have been as they have chosen to, in simple faith, walk in obedience to the scriptures and be able to develop their love. And Lydia develop her love from just an emotional love to a physical love. But it's not only emotional and it's not only physical, but love is a choice. It's for that reason that Paul told Titus to instruct the older women in the churches to teach the younger women to love their husbands. I didn't quite get that till I was married and understood there are days that I am unlovely. I am unlovable, downright grumpy. And there will be days in Christian's job where he is going to see the worst of human nature. But when he comes home, it will be your responsibility to show him the love of Christ and to have your home filled with love and be a haven for him. And so on those days, I challenge you, Lydia, when Christian is unlovely or comes home from work grumpy, that you choose to love him. And that on the days where he shows love, you choose to outlove him. It's a really fun thing when a husband and wife are battling who can love the other one the most. So we celebrate the love of a husband. We celebrate the love of a wife. But most importantly today, we celebrate the love of God. For it was this love that sent Jesus to die, as it says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The love of God would send his Son to die for a cruel and hateful and sinful world. Romans 5:8 tells us that God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God did not wait until we could approach him. God sent his Son to us to die on the cross for our sin. While we were sinners and because we were sinners, Christ died. You know, the relationship of the bride and groom in the Song of Solomon pictures the relationship of Christ and his church. And in the Song of Solomon chapter 1, beginning in verse number 5, we find the bride who is ashamed of herself. She's been burnt by the sun. She spent a lot of time in the sun, and she refers to herself. She says, I'm black but comely, O ye daughters of Jerusalem, as the tents of Kedar, as the curtains of Solomon. Look not upon me because I'm black, because the sun hath looked upon me. My mother's children were angry with me. They made me the keeper of the vineyards, but mine own vineyard have I not kept. There was shame with the bride. She didn't want people looking upon her. She didn't even want her groom at this moment looking upon her. And it really shows us and how we need to be to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. We have to recognize that we are sinners, that we are unworthy of experiencing his love. We are unworthy of the forgiveness that Christ provided for us when he died on the cross and shed his blood. Yet we see what the king's response is to his bride. When a few moments later he says at the beginning of verse 7, O thou whom my soul loveth. She saw herself as sunburnt. She saw herself as sinful. But he said, O thou whom my soul loveth. And then in the next verse he said, O thou fairest among women. The love we see in Christian's eyes today for Lydia should be a reminder to every one of us of the love that God has for each one of us. I remember one of the first times I had ever seen Christian. The first time I really talked to him, it was in evangelism class at Smite Camp in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and I was teaching the Wordless Book class. And I remember noticing Christian and Jacob's shoes the first day. They had really cool shoes. And I was older than them, and I was the teacher, but I was amazed by their shoes. But I saw something in Christian that week as he learned to witness to kids, and then over the last few years have seen him spend a lot of time in the summers. When I came on staff at North Belt in Houston, that first year, I guess it was, I saw potential and asked him to help lead in the Vacation Bible School. But I've seen him reach out to kids and bring the gospel to kids. I've seen Lydia with the heart for the lost. There's been more than once she's come to me crying with a burden for somebody who was lost, asking me to pray. So both of these have a great burden for people to come to know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. And I just want to encourage each of you who are here today, if you do not know the forgiveness of your sins, If Jesus Christ, if you do not have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, there's nothing more that Christian and Lydia would want today, nothing better than for you to come to know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, to receive Him today. Back to that first verse when I was talking about the love of God, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him. I encourage you now, if you have never put your faith in Jesus Christ, to trust Him today for your salvation. Place your faith in Him. Come to know the love that He has for you. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank You for Christian and for Lydia. Lord, I thank You for the testimony that they have been to us in their single time of having a burden for the lost. Both working in different children's programs, some outdoors, some on this very property. Lord, I thank You for the tender heart that You've given them, for those who would die and spend an eternity in hell separated from You. And Lord, I just pray that if there's any one of these family or guests here today that doesn't know You as their Savior, that they would place their faith in You even now, confessing their sin to You, and receiving the gift, the free gift that You offer of eternal life, and that they would be able to know fellowship with You. Lord, I pray as we exchange these vows for Christian and Lydia, Lord, that You would bind their hearts even more together, and as they become one today, that You would bless their union. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Christian, do you take this woman to be your lawfully wedded wife, to live together after God's law in marriage?
I do.
Will you love her, comfort her, honor her, keep her in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep yourself for her alone as long as you both shall live?
I will.
Lydia, do you take this man to be your lawfully wedded husband, to live together after God's law in marriage?
I do.
Will you love him, honor him, submit to him, keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep yourself for him alone as long as you both shall live?
I will.
Now I call on each of you, the family and friends of Christian and Lydia, and I ask you to respond with an I will. Will you support and uphold their marriage in love and prayer now and in the years to come? The vows we're going to share now, we're going to begin with the traditional vows, but then Christian and Lydia have also written some vows on their own for one another. So Christian, would you repeat after me? I, Christian, take you, Lydia.
I, Christian, take you, Lydia.
For my lawfully wedded wife.
For my lawfully wedded wife.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
For richer or for poorer.
For richer or for poorer.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part. I promise to support you physically, emotionally, and spiritually. With God's help, I will protect you, take care of you, and learn to put you first, always before myself. I will strive to love you as Christ loved the church. I will be a leader for you and our family in the good times and the difficult times. I will be forever yours. I love you, Lydia.
Lydia, would you repeat after me? I, Lydia, take you, Christian.
I, Lydia, take you, Christian.
For my lawfully wedded husband.
For my lawfully wedded husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
For richer or for poorer.
For richer or for poorer.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part. I will be a support to you physically, emotionally, and spiritually. With God's help, I will submit to you as the head of our home, to put you first, always before myself. I will strive to follow you wherever you lead me, in the good times and in the difficult times. I will be forever yours. I love you, Christian.
May I have Lydia's ring? This ring, these rings they're exchanging today are a symbol of their love for one another. Being a circle, they represent an unending relationship. God intended this union to be brought together, and he intended it to be a lasting union. And so as we exchange these vows, we are making a lifelong commitment. Christian, would you take the rings, place them on her finger, and repeat after me? With this ring.
With this ring.
I thee wed.
I thee wed.
And all my worldly goods.
And all my worldly goods.
With you I share.
With you I share.
I have Christian's ring. Take the ring, place it on his finger, and repeat after me, Lydia. With this ring. With this ring.
With this ring.
I thee wed.
I thee wed.
And all my worldly goods.
And all my worldly goods.
With you I share.
With you I share.
The Lord bless you, Christian, to love Lydia as Christ loves the church. May you be a selfless leader, a strong protector, a passionate lover, and a faithful friend. May the Lord be your constant shield and ever-present help in trouble. The Lord bless you, Lydia, to honor Christian and to submit to him as unto the Lord. May you be a humble helpmeet, a strong support, a passionate lover, and a faithful friend. May the Lord bless you with abundant grace and enduring peace. The Lord bless you both to be as one. May you be faithful to each other and to God's purposes. May your union bring many lost souls into his kingdom. Let us pray. Father, we ask your blessing on this union. Lord, we thank you that you have brought Christian and Lydia together. We thank you for the testimony, the godly, pure testimony that they have been to each one of us as they have sought to follow you. Lord, as they have sought your direction and your guidance, we thank you for bringing them together today. Lord, we pray that you would bind them together in all areas, Lord, physically, emotionally, spiritually, that they would be one. Bless Christian as the head of the home, and I pray that you would bless Lydia as his helpmeet. Lord, bless them and use them mightily in your kingdom. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
My friend, you're
everything that meets my heart's desire. And through you the Lord has blessed beyond my dreams. Yes, through you, the Lord has blessed beyond my dreams.
Lydia wrote that just for Christian recently. By the power vested in me by Almighty God, His church, and the great state of Texas, I now pronounce you husband and wife. Wherefore, they are no more twain, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let not man put asunder. Christian, you may kiss your bride. It is my great honor and privilege to introduce to you Mr. and Mrs. Christian Patrick Poteet.
Thank you.
There will be a reception following in the back of the room here. But with that said, we need to create a little more space for the reception. So as soon as we're dismissed here, we're going to be taking up some chairs in the back. So if you're set up behind these cameras here, if you'll go ahead and take your things as you get up, we can remove those chairs. We're just going to be a big, happy family today. So if you want to throw in some extra backs and help us pick up some chairs there, we'll get the reception started shortly. At approximately 7 o'clock this evening, the couple will be leaving. They'll be flying out. And so you are welcome to go with us down to the airstrip. But we will be going together as a group and meeting them down there. And so the announcement will be made somewhere around 7 o'clock-ish. In here, we'll make the announcement, and then we'll all go down to the airstrip together. And you are welcome to stay for that if you'd like to. Thank you so much. Have a blessed afternoon.
Were you playing cello since you were this big?
When I started